Hello, this is part two of lecture two of linear algebra. This is the most important part of this lecture. This part is about linear dependence, linear independence, and the basis of a linear subspace. First, we define what is linear dependence. If we have m vectors in n-dimensional space, v1, v2, up to vm, we say that these vectors are linearly dependent if there exist linear combinations of these vectors, which is zero, and such that at least one coefficient in this linear combination is not zero. So by definition, these vectors v1, v2, vm are said to be linearly dependent if you can find m real numbers, lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda m, such that this sum is zero, but at least one number among lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda m is not zero. This is actually an important condition. So if we know for sure that, for example, that lambda m is not zero, then we can divide by lambda m and we can express vm as a linear combination of the remaining vectors. However, from the beginning, we don't know which number among lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda m is not zero. So it can be lambda m, it can be lambda 1, it can be lambda 2. If you're sure that, for example, lambda m is not zero, then you can always express vm using this equality as a linear combination of the remaining vectors. So here's an example of linearly dependent vectors. You can check that this sum is a zero vector. Okay, to prove that vectors are linearly dependent, you have to find such numbers, lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda m, such that the sum of these vectors taken with this coefficients is zero. Okay, now we can use this definition to define what is linear independence. Well, as it follows from the word independence, vectors are said to be linearly independent if they are not linearly dependent. So basically, you can restate it in this logical implication. If you have vectors v1, v2, vm, they are linearly independent if you have the following logical implication. If you have linear combination of those vectors, which is zero, then all coefficients in this sum must be zero. Okay, this is another way how you can restate linear independence. But I find it easier to basically define linear independence as not linearly dependent. Okay, first example, if you take a standard vectors, e1, e2, en, they are linearly independent. How to check it? By definition. Suppose that they are linearly dependent and try to derive a contradiction. If they are linearly dependent, there exist some numbers, lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda n in this case, such that if you take linear combinations of these vectors with coefficients lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda n, then you want at least one of these numbers, lambda I, to be non-zero, and you want the total sum to be zero. But the sum of these vectors with these coefficients is a vector with entries lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda n. So it is zero if and only if all of these numbers, lambda I, are zeros. And this basically means a contradiction to the definition of being linearly dependent. Another important observation, if you have some list of vectors, such that this list contains zero vector, then these vectors are automatically linearly dependent. Why? Because, as we already mentioned, zero vectors is a linear combination of any other vectors. So this immediately gives you linear dependence. If you just look at the definition of linear dependence on the previous slide. And here, nice example in two-dimensional space, which is going to be actually part of your tutorial problem. So if you have vectors a, b, c, and d, and you can consider two vectors a, b, and c, d, so these two vectors are linearly independent if and only if ad minus bc is not equal to zero. So of course, once you see two vectors a, b, and c, d, subconsciously you want to cook up a matrix out of them, and this number ad minus bc, as already mentioned in the last lecture, it's said to be determinant of this 2x2 matrix. We will going to consider determinants a little bit later, but anyway, this is a useful property to have. This has to be proven. This is a part of tutorial problem. Okay, now let's try to restate, compare linear independence and basic properties of linear combinations. We already did this in the when we defined linear dependence. Let's just do it more or less one more time with more details. So we consider m vectors in n dimensional space, v1, v2, vm. And this is actually the lemma in the lecture notes. And the following three conditions are equivalent. These vectors are linearly independent. Or the second condition, no vector vi in this list is a linear combination of others. And the third property, for every vector in the span of these vectors, v1, v2, vm, this vector in the span x can be represented as a linear combination of vectors v1, vm uniquely, with a unique choice of these numbers lambda 1, lambda n. These three properties are equivalent, so it's strongly suggested to prove this yourself. This gives you the feeling what's going on. But for example, implicitly, we already briefly proved that 1 and 2 are sort of equivalent. Remember, for example, if you want to prove that 1 implies 2, basically you just need to take just by definition, you're supposed to that vectors are linear independent, and you assume that property 2 doesn't hold. What does it mean? It means that, for example, one of those vectors vi is a linear combination of others. Without loss of generality, you might assume this is vm, so it means vm is lambda 1 times v1 plus lambda 2 times v2 plus blah 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 lambda m minus 1 times vm minus 1. And then you write this as an expression, and you immediately obtain a contradiction with linear independence of vectors v1, vm. Okay, and the property 3, the equivalence to the properties 1 and 2, you can prove it similarly, basically assume that this representation as a sum of as a linear combination of vectors v1, vm is not unique. And basically you subtract two different such representations and you obtain contradiction to linear independence. So this is done in the lecture notes. This is done in the book. It's strongly suggested to prove it by yourself. This gives us very nice corollary, which most of people use subconsciously. So if you have some collection of linear independent vectors, v1, v2, up to vm, then if you take any sublist of this list, then this sublist consists of linearly independent vectors. For example, if you drop last vector from the list, and what is left is a vectors v1, v2, vm minus 1, then this vector is going to be linearly independent. If vectors v1, v2, vm are linearly independent. This, of course, follows from the definition of linear independence. Okay. Now we consider one, in my opinion, super important proposition. It's called Steinitz exchange lemma, which basically going to be used in many result in the remaining part of this lecture. And it's very, very, very nice result. Basically, I may say in this lecture, this is the most important result. Okay, we fix some vector subspace in n-dimensional space in Rn, and then we take some collection v1, v2, vm of linear independent vectors in this subspace. Again, vector subspace is the same thing as a linear subspace. It's just another name. Okay, so then we take some spinning set for the vector subspace V. Let it be vectors W1, WK. So here, W1, WK, vectors that span V, and V1, Vm are linearly independent vectors in V. Einsteinitz's lemma says that M should be less or equal than K. So the number of linear independent vectors in the subspace cannot be larger than the number of spanning vectors. Okay. Intuitively, this is clear. For example, if I add to the spanning set any number of additional vectors, I still get the spanning set. So this number k, basically, if I wish, I can replace by any number I like. So it can be as large as possible. But number of linear independent vectors, as we see from this lemma, is actually bounded. It cannot be too large. Okay, this is important lemma. It's proof, very detailed proof, is given in the lecture notes. I strongly suggest to try, at least to try to prove this proposition by yourself. The proof is actually not easy. In the lecture notes, the idea of the proof is basically induction on K. And when K is, for example, zero, what does it mean when K is zero? It means that the V is a zero subspace. Vector subspace V is spanned by zero number of vectors, it's a zero subspace. So in this case, we cannot have any linear independent vectors in V, basically, because as I already mentioned, if you have a zero vector in a list, it's automatically linearly independent. But in this case, all these vectors V1, Vn should be zero. So it's contradictory independent. So if K is zero, then M also should be zero, should be no vectors in the list. This is the base of induction. And if you assume K is bigger or equal than one, then this is a bit tricky part of the proof. You a little bit change this proposition such that it's easier to prove it by induction. So basically the main idea of the proof in the lecture notes. So instead of proving this proposition, you prove slightly stronger statement. So you have inequality M less than equal than K, and you can change the spanning set of V in such a way that instead of W1, you put one vectors in your list V1, Vm. In your list of linear independent vectors. Yeah, so without generality, you may assume, without loss of generality, you may assume that W1 is actually equal V1. Yeah, and then you continue your proof and you obtain the result. Okay, this is a bit sketchy, but I strongly suggest just to take a look in the lecture notes for the proof. Okay, so this lemma immediately gives us very nice corollary. So if you have K vectors in n-dimensional space, Rn, and K is larger than n, then they automatically linearly dependent. Why? Because we already know from the previous slides that if you have a standard vectors in Rn, E1, E2, En, that they span Rn. N-dimensional space Rn are spanned by n vectors. So you just apply Steinitz's exchange lemma, and you see that if you have k vectors in this space, or k bigger than n, then they must be linearly dependent. Okay, good. So let me give one very interesting, in my opinion, application of this corollary. Let's consider one example. Let's take n times n square matrix, n is anything. Then you can add matrix M to itself, for example, you can multiply matrix M by a number. You can take a power of matrix M, you can take M square, M cube. If you defined zero power of M is just identity matrix, and you take the sum of powers. And what does it mean? It basically means that you can substitute your matrix M into the polynomial. So for example, if you take some polynomial like this, and he A0, A1, A2, AD minus 1 are some real numbers. So if you substitute M into this polynomial, you have this expression. And instead of A0, you get A0 times identity. So because, as I already mentioned, M to the power of 0 is just, we define it to be identity matrix. Yeah. And so you can substitute matrix M into any polynomial. And using this corollary, we can see that there exists such polynomial such that you substitute matrix M into this polynomial and you get a zero matrix. So it, look here, this sum, it's a matrix n times n. Yeah. So this zero basically means a lot of zeros. It's a zero matrix. Yeah. Why such polynomial exists? The sketch of the proof of its existence. You just take powers of m. Zero powers of m is identity. First power of m is m. Second power of m, m square. And continue. So you go to m to the power of d, where d is n square. How many matrices you have? You have n square plus one matrix. But matrices form n squared. You can think of them as they live in n squared dimensional vector space. Yeah. What is n times n matrix? It's n square entries. So if you basically you just put them into the square grid, imagine that you just can put all of the rows of the matrix one after another. So you can think of M as an element of R n squared. So applying this lemma, this corollary with n equal n square, so you replace this n by n square, you immediately get that all powers of m from zero power to n square power must be linearly dependent. So there exist some numbers, lambda zero, lambda one up to lambda d square, such that the combination, linear combination is zero. And at least one of this lambda i's is not zero. This gives you this polynomial after scaling on the coefficient in front of the top power. Okay, that's basically it for this slide. So what I want to basically stress that this proposition, the Steinitz exchange lemma, is very powerful and very useful in many applications. Okay, and now we are ready, using this basically Steinitz lemma, we're ready to give a definition of a basis of a linear subspace. First, let me remind you that every vector in Rn can be written as a linear combination of standard vectors, e1, e2, up to en. Yeah? And it can be done in exactly one way. Why? Because basically lambda one here is a first entry of vector x, and lambda two going to be second entry, and lambda n is a final nth entry. Okay, so now we can use this property basically to define a basis of any linear subspace. So let V be a linear subspace of Rn. And a basis of this subspace is a list of vectors, V1 up to Vm, such that they both linearly independent and they both span linear subspace V. So this means that this set of vectors is a spanning set. At the same time, this list of vectors are linearly independent, both independent and both span V. Okay, so as we already know, that the fact that they're linear independent means that any of the linear combination is giving unique representation. Any vector in the span can be uniquely represented as a linear combination. So since by this assumption, this vector span V, it means that every vector in V can be uniquely represented as a linear combination of the same vectors. And this is exactly reminds what going on with vectors E1, En. Okay, so basically by this definition, E1, En form a basis of the vector space Rn. And we usually called this basis as a standard basis. Okay, here's a more delicate example. Let's consider three-dimensional space R3, and let's consider a plane passing through the origin in this space given by this equation x1 plus x2 plus x3 equal to zero. Then one can check that these two vectors, they contained in this subset V, subspace V, and they form a basis. Okay, how to show that they form a basis? You have to check two things. First, that they span V, so that every vector in V can be obtained as a linear combination of those two vectors. And the second, that they are linear independent. Both is not very hard, but has to be done explicitly. You cannot just say that this is true. You have to actually justify it. We're not going to do it here, but it's a good exercise to do it by yourself. Okay. Now we're ready to give another important definition, probably one of the most important definition in this lecture, which is based on the following proposition. Any two bases of a linear subspace have the same number of elements. Why? You have to apply Steinitz exchange lemma. You take two bases and by each of them span your vector subspace V. Each collection of vectors are linear independent. So by Steinitz lemma, immediately you derive the number of elements in both bases are the same. Okay, so in particular, every basis of Rn contains exactly n vectors. So for example, if you have R3 and you have two vectors in R3, you know for sure that they cannot span R3. And vice versa, if you have, for example, four vectors in R3, they cannot be linearly independent, which we already actually know from the previous slide. This is direct corollary of Steinitz lemma. So what I just said can be actually generalized for any vector spaces. So we can state it as two lemmas. One we call deletion lemma, one we call extension lemma. Deletion lemma says the following. So if you have a vector subspace V, and if you just take a bunch of vectors V1, Vm, which span V, you don't know that these vectors form a basis. But what you know, that you can get rid from some of vectors on this list, and you get a basis of V. So how to prove this? Okay, if vectors V1, Vm are linearly independent, you're done. I mean, it's, the set is already form a basis by definition. If some of them are linearly if they are linearly dependent, then you know from one of the properties of equivalent conditions for being linearly dependent, you know that one of these vectors is a linear combination of others. So for example, without loss of generality, you may assume that Vm is a linear combination of vectors V1 up to Vm minus one. So, but then if you get rid of this vector from this list, if you only consider vectors V1, Vm minus one, then they're gonna span your vector space V by one of the remarks which I made earlier in this lecture. So from this immediately follows that if you repeat this procedure, sooner or later, there are going to be no vectors to get rid of, and you're going to get a basis of your vector space. So you cannot, number of vectors in this list is finite, so this procedure have to stop at some point. Okay, and the complementary lemma, extension lemma, basically you can see it's very similar. So if you have k linear independent vectors in V, but you don't know that they span your vector space V, but what you know that you can add few vectors to this list such that you get a basis. So you can extend this list to a basis of V. Okay, again, how to prove this? So if V1, Vk span V, you're done. By definition, they already form a basis. So you may assume this is not the case. What does it mean? It means there exists some vector W in V, which is not linear combination of V1, Vk. So because you assume that V cannot be spanned by this vectors V1, Vk. So you take this vector W and you just add it to the list. And you have to check accurately, this is a crucial point, that the new list of k plus one vectors is linearly independent. Once you check this, you can repeat this procedure and you keep adding vectors to your list. But we know from Steinitz lemma and from previous corollary on the previous slide, you know that this process has to stop, because you cannot have more than n linearly independent vectors in Rn. So at some point this process terminates and gives you a basis of vector space V. Okay, and we have a nice corollary of this, that every linear subspace of Rn has at least one basis. Because so far we always assume that there is some spanning set and maybe set of linear independent vectors. Now we know that every linear subspace has at least one basis. Okay, let me consider few examples. So first example is in R3, in three-dimensional space, let's consider the same plane which you already considered in the earlier. Yeah. So you take vectors V1, V2, V3 like this, 1, 2, 3, 1, 0, minus 1, 1, 4, minus 5. And you can check that this vectors span V. But they are linearly dependent. And you may check that any two of them form a basis. So if you, for example, remove V3, these two vectors V1, V2, they form a basis. They're going to be linear independent. It's actually not hard to see that any two vectors among the three are linearly independent. Yeah, but three of them are not linear independent, but they span V. Okay, take another example. So basically, first example is illustration of deletion lemma, and let us illustrate extension lemma. You take two vectors, V1, V2. It's not hard to see that they're linear independent. By the way, how to check this? By definition, you assume, if you want to prove that they're linear independent, you assume that they are dependent and try to derive a contradiction. You assume there exist some numbers A and B such that A times V1 plus B times V2 equal to 0. It's a zero vector. So this gives you three equations, two unknowns, A and B, and you derive that both A and B are zero. So which contradicts linear dependency. Okay, so these two vectors are linearly independent, and suppose we want to extend them to a basis in R3. How to do this? Okay, there's no unique recipe how to do this. Basically, in this case, you just can grab any vector which is not contained in the span of these two vectors. For example, I took vector 1, 0, 0, add this to the list, and I claim these three vectors form a basis of R3. Why? The only thing I have to prove that basically that they are linearly independent. By the Steinitz lemma, if I know that these three guys are linearly independent, it implies that they must span R3. Yeah, so again, you have to check this by definition that they are linearly independent. They are, and so they form a basis of R3. In the future, a little bit later, you will learn some tricks how to immediately see that, for example, these three vectors are linearly independent. But we're not going to discuss these tricks now. Okay. Now we go to the promised main definition of a main definition of this lecture, dimension. Okay, I must admit, in this lecture and in the previous lecture, quite often I said Rn is an n-dimensional space. And basically, we even defined vectors as a vectors of this in this n-dimensional space. But to be precise, we actually never define dimension. We use the word dimension intuitively. But now we're ready to give precise definition of a dimension of the linear subspace. In particular, we can define dimension of Rn and we can compute it. So what is dimension? Dimension of a linear subspace is a number of vectors in a basis of U. We already know from the corollary of Steinitz lemma that the number of vectors in any basis of a given linear subspace is the same. So this number doesn't depend on the choice of basis. There are a lot of different bases of any vector subspace. There are no unique bases. There is no the basis. There's always a basis. There's a lot of different bases of a given vector subspace. But the number of vectors in any basis, it's the same. So this is, by definition, dimension of the linear subspace, or we can say dimension of a vector subspace. Yeah. So in particular, if you have a zero subspace, it has no vectors except zero vector. So its dimension is zero. There's no basis in this vector. In this vector space by definition, because zero vector always linearly dependent. Yes. And another extreme example, you take the whole Rn, we know this is a vector subspace, of course. Yeah. And its dimension is n. Again, why? Because we know that if we take a standard basis, E1, E2, En, then the standard basis is linearly independent. Its span Rn, so it's a basis. And we know that any number or number of elements in any basis is the same, so it has to be n. Okay. And if you use Steinitz lemma again, you can derive this lemma, which is super handy. So let me clarify what this lemma tells us. So we take two vector subspaces, W and V. And we assume that V is contained in W. Then dimension of V should be at most dimension of W. Moreover, if dimension of V is the same as dimension of W, then these two vector subspaces are the same. how to prove this. For example, you can use either deletion lemma or extension lemma. I think it's easy in this case. Extension lemma, or we better say you can use the proof of extension lemma. You can choose a basis in V. We know that there exists basis in V. So you fix a basis in V, and since V is in W, you can extend basis of V to the basis of W. How? The same way we sketch the proof of extension lemma. You just, if W already spanned by the basis of V, it means that these two vector subspaces coincide. And in this case, you have to do nothing. If W is strictly larger than V, then there exists a vector in W, which is not linear span of vectors in the basis of V. Then you just take one such vector and you add to the basis of V. And this list of vectors should be linear independent. You can prove it the same as we mentioned in the proof of the extension lemma. And then you keep doing this, and then until you reach the basis of W. And by definition, this basis of W contains as a sublist as a basis of V. So the number of elements in the basis of V is less or equal to the number of elements in the basis of W, and you get this inequality. And if you have equality, then by definition, it means that these two bases are the same. So if they are the same, then they span are the same, and they span V and W respectively. So this should be the equality here. Okay, this is very handy lemma. Let me give you one example how to apply it. So suppose you have three-dimensional space R3, and let's consider vector subspace V in R3, which is given by these two equations. I claim that its dimension is one. Okay, how to do this? So first of all, if you use this lemma, and you think, okay, what's could be the dimension of V? Dimension of V cannot be four or larger than four because V lives in R3. So dimension of V is at most R3. Also, dimension of V actually equals R3, equals three, only if V is equal R3. But this is clearly not the case. You can find a vector in R3, which is not in V. Yeah, so for example, I can take vector 1, 1 minus 1, minus 2, 1, 1 minus 2. This vector lives here, but it's not other way around. I may say you take any vector in R3 which is not in V. Take vector 1, 1, 1. It doesn't satisfy first equation. So it satisfies second equation, but doesn't satisfy first. So it's not in V. What does it mean? It means that R3 is different from V, so dimension of V strictly less than 3. Okay, can dimension of V be 2? By the same reason, no. Let's take the vector subspace given by x1 plus x2 plus x3 equal to 0. Yeah, and by the same reason, we see that dimension of this vector subspace given just by first equation cannot be 3, because we already proved this. We took the vector 1, 1, 1. It's not in this subspace. So dimension of x1 plus x2 plus x3 equal to 0 of this hyperplane is not 3. So dimension of this hyperplane is at most 2. But I claim that this hyperplane is different from V. Why? Because I can find a vector in this hyperplane which is not contained in V. So I cannot apply this lemma, and I must have strict inequality. So for example, I can take vector 1, minus 1, 0. This vector is contained in this hyperplane, but it's doesn't satisfy this equation. So it's not contained in V. So what I just proved? I proved that we have dimension of phi should be strictly less than dimension of a hyperplane given by this equation, and it's strictly less than 3. Okay, so it means that dimension of V is at most 1. But on the other hand, can it, if it's at most 1, then I have only dimension as a non-negative integer, so we have only two choices for dimension of V, 0 or 1. Can it be 0? If it's 0, it means it's a zero vector space. It means there's no vectors here except 0. But this is not the case. You can find at least one non-zero vector here. For example, you can have vector with coordinate 1, 1, and then -2. So it satisfies this equation, satisfies this equation. So we found at least one vector in V. So its dimension is positive. It's positive and it's strictly less than 2. So it must be 1. And also this proof that dimension of the, there's only one choice for dimension of the hyperplane x1 plus x2 plus x3 equal to 0, it should be 2, because it has to be by this lemma larger than 1 and less than 3. Okay, this is quite handy. It's sometimes a little bit boring to apply. In the future you will learn better methods how to compute dimension of a vector subspace, but you can apply it in some cases. Let's consider one very nice application. It's not directly related to linear algebra course, it's more geometry, but I find it to be nice application of linear algebra. Let's fix five relatively random points in the plane. I just basically picked up these points randomly for this example. And then I claim that there exists unique conic in the plane that contain these five points. What is a conic? In the first part of the first lecture, I introduce cubic curves. Curves is given by polynomial equation of degree 2 in the plane. Conics are simpler, they're given by polynomial equations of degree 2. So, sorry, cubics given by polynomial equations of degree 3, conics given by polynomial equations of degree 2. Yeah, so conic is a curve in the plane which is given by this equation for some numbers a1, a2, a3, a4, a5, a6. Yeah, so I claim that for this collection of points, there exists unique curve given by this polynomial equation, which pass through them. How to check it? Very similar what we did in the first part of the first lecture. You just substitute coordinates of these five points into this equation, and you get this system of equations. And yeah, you can observe that these five equations, they actually define your linear subspace in six-dimensional space. Why? Because basically you can translate this into the matrix form, and you can check that this is a kernel of a matrix, which basically this matrix consists of coefficients of these equations. Yeah, this is, we will do it in tutorials a little bit in more detail. So this is a little bit sketchy, but it's okay. So this is a vector space. So then you can actually check that this, using the lemma on the previous slide, that this linear subspace is one dimensional. Moreover, if you have enough time, or if you have any computer algebra package, you can actually find at least one solution. You can find at least one solution of this system of equations. And then once you found one solution and you know it's one dimensional, the fact that it's one dimensional tells you that all other solutions can be obtained from the solution you found, non-zero solution you found, by scaling. You just take your solution. What does it mean? It forms, it's non-zero vector, it's one vector, it's non-zero vector. So it forms a basis of one dimensional vector space. So it means all other vectors which give you solution of the system can be obtained from solution you found by scaling. But this is exactly means that this equation which determines this curve is unique up to scaling. Of course, if you have this equation, if you multiply it by two, of course, you're going to get slightly different equation, but it's clearly defined the same curve. Yeah. So this means that this conic is unique and you can actually find its equation like this. Yeah. This is the one solution which I found. I must admit, not by hands, I use Python. Okay, basically, this is almost everything for this lecture. Let me just briefly mention, this is not important for this lecture, but let me briefly mention that almost everything what we discussed in this lecture are true over arbitrary field. If you're uncomfortable with the word field, just think about complex numbers, or think about, for example, field consisting of two elements, zero and one, or field consisting of five elements, zero, one, three, four, with multiplication we describe in the fourth part of lecture one. So as I already mentioned, a lot of results in linear algebra remains true over arbitrary field. Not all results, but many. Yeah, and everything what we did today can be done in n-dimensional vector space where entries of vectors, coordinates of vectors are elements on any given field F. So for example, if you take examples which I already considered, if you take, for example, this hyperplane in F3 given by this equation, you can prove that its dimension is two, basically by applying the same lemma, which we already used. Dimension cannot be three because we have a vector in F3 which is not in this hyperplane. Like, say, take vector 1, 1, 1, unless F is F3. Yeah, and from this you derive the dimension of V is two. Yeah. So what does it mean? Dimension is two. It basically means it has a basis which consists of two vectors, and every element in F can be uniquely given as a linear combination of these two vectors. So it basically means if you denote this vector by v1, v2, that every element here is given by a1 v1 plus a2 v2 for unique choice of a1 and a2. So in a very special case when n f is finite, you have exactly this number of vectors in V, because this all possible possibilities for the coefficients of your linear combination. Yeah, this a1 and a2 each belongs to f, and if F consists, for example, of n elements, that you have n choices for A1, n choices for A2. And since this expression is unique, so you have n square choices for all vectors in V. So this gives you n square vector where n is the number of elements in F. Okay. Similar example, which I just did on the previous slide, you can consider over arbitrary field. Okay, here's a small typo. I wanted to say F3. I forgot to replace R by F. Yeah, so absolutely like in the previous slide, we can prove the dimension of this vector subspace is one, and one its basis is given by this vector. Yeah, this is makes sense over any field, because one is element of every field. This is another one, and this is one plus one, and then you multiply by minus one, where minus one is the inverse of one, additive inverse of one. Yeah. So what does it mean? It means that every vector in W can be obtained from this vector by scaling. You just multiply it by some lambda. So usually lambda belongs to infinite set. Usually we have infinitely many choices for lambda, but if F is a finite field which consists of, say, n elements, then We have exactly n choices for this lambda, and it basically means we have exactly n vectors in W. So this is very handy observation, which you can use actually for counting for how many vectors you have in some vector subspace if you do linear algebra over finite fields. Okay, let me stop this lecture.